Well, good evening, everyone. Are you guys excited for a night of country, bluegrass, gospel music? I'm just going to tell you now, your hearts are going to be warmed. Your souls are going to fly tonight. So just sit back and enjoy. I'm Matthew. I'm going to get us started here in just a moment. But I thought we would just honor our amazing musicians. Can you join me in honoring our amazing musicians this morning, this evening? Woo! So here on vocals, I'm going to start with Renee, the beautiful Renee Hardy. Over to my right, we have on violin, Jetta Brooks. And I heard we possibly might hear from her little brother, Roscoe, later. So that might be a special treat, but we'll wait and see about that one. And then next we have David Gerthung on mandolin. And right behind me here on the upright bass, we have Honey Deaton. And then on the piano, we have Donna Huntley. And I've saved the best for last, and this red-haired woman is originally, I'll just share a little bit. Can I share just a little bit about her? She's an amazing woman. She originally comes from the Ozark Mountains. Ozark Mountains, I had to look that up today. That's Arkansas, Missouri, and Oklahoma. So the music that you're gonna hear tonight has its roots in her family. When she was four, she relocated to the Owyhee Mountains by Sucker Creek. Her mom played the banjo and I believe the banjo and the mandolin, and her dad played the guitar. So she grew up in a home full of music, full of wonderful singing. She has a passion for Jesus. Yeah. She's a member here at Valley Church. She enrolled this past fall in our adult school of ministry. And she's actually one of my students, and I love having her in her class because she just glows with the love of Jesus, and she has all kinds of wisdom and experience and stories to tell. She's produced many, many records through Nashville, and there's some CDs outside that you can enjoy afterwards. But would you join me in welcoming Betty Adams?
Thank you. Thank you. And hello, everybody. Woo! Yes, look at you all. You look so wonderful. I'm so happy to see you. Can't wait to get started. We're going to start off tonight with a good old hoedown. Now, I think the Lord says to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, right? I don't think there's any more joyful sound in this world than a good old hoedown. Do you? All right, kick her off, guys. Here we go. Yeah! Wasn't that a beautiful, joyful noise to the Lord? Woo-hoo! All right. Well, we're so glad that you came tonight to celebrate with us, because this is just the most fun we could have, worshiping the Lord and get just singing these beautiful songs to Him. We're going to start out with one here that you'll all recognize. And we don't have the words up here, but a lot of you older people, some of you guys, will recognize some of these words. So just sing along with us and have a good time with us, okay? Here we go. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? How many remember that song? Woo-hoo! All right. Well, we might play it a little different than y'all heard it before, but it's going to be good. All right, Donna, kick it off. For the cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Sing it! Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Everybody, are you washed in the blood? The sweetest thing in this world to be washed in the blood of the Lamb and to have His rest. Amen. You can clap for that. Woohoo! No peace in the world like the peace that the Lord Jesus gives us. Okay. Now, how many of you were raised in the country? Let me see. Look at you. No wonder y'all are here tonight. Of course you were. Well, so was I, and my mama would cook breakfast on an old Monarch kitchen range. How many of you know what those are? Oh, look at you. See, we're in such good company tonight. Well, my mommy would get up early to cook breakfast for six kids, and I was number six. And so she would build a fire and then make biscuits and sausage and eggs and all that good old Southern stuff. But while she was doing it, she would sing. And I remember so much this next song that we're going to do. We'll understand it better by and by. And times were really hard. But you know, she sang in the hard times. I love to sing this old song. Y'all sing it with us, okay? We'll understand it better by and by. As soon as I turn my page. Don't want. There we go. All right, kick it off. Anything happened this week that you didn't understand? Yeah. Doesn't feel very good, you know. But we can't just exactly like the song says, but with trusting in the Lord and according to his word, we will understand it better by and by. Now, this is one of the funnest songs in the world. I love it. And we have Miss Honey Deaton on the bass. And yeah. We originally had Jim Nimmo playing the bass, but last night he called and he says, "Betty, I am so sick." And I said, "Oh, I'm so sorry." And he said, "I don't think I can make it tomorrow." So I had, the reason I didn't ask Honey in the first place is she's the busiest person in the whole wide world. And I thought, you know, Lord Jesus, you're in charge of this. And I called Honey and I said, she says, "Hello," so sweet. And I said, "Honey, do you have, are you booked up for Sunday night?" She said, "Aunt Betty, I'm not." Give her a hand. Wasn't that wonderful? Woo! And this little old song that there's power in the blood. How many like that song? Amen. Woo! I do too. And this features Honey on the bass and Donna on the piano. So we're going to do that right now for you. Glad for that power, power in the blood. We don't hear a lot about the blood of Jesus anymore. We do it at this church, but a lot of the more sophisticated churches, we don't hear it so much. But, you know, that's our salvation. That's why we are where we are. And thankful for the precious blood of Jesus. Now, how many saw these little teeny old roses up here? Aren't they beautiful? All right, since you ask, I will. That's my favorite thing in the whole wide world. You know that I'm really grateful to have been raised out on Sucker Creek. And the freedoms and the beautiful things that we were taught out there. But my mommy told you had six kids, plus she watched the grandchildren. And Elaine was a part of that. Billy Ray Purdom was a part of that. I saw Bill over there. And so it was wonderful for us all to grow up together. And Mama had a huge garden, but she didn't have a flower garden. She had one little yellow rose that was those kind of wild kind that grow down by the creek. And they have their own beautiful smell. They aren't big like these, but they're delightful. And she had one little teeny rose bush. And she nurtured that thing and doctored that thing and loved it. Well, when I was just about a teenager, we moved away from the ranch to farm, and we moved into the big town, Homedale. And I still love Homedale. And so then my brother and his family lived there. Bill lived there. And then they built new houses, and the old home place just was left there. And then some energetic neighbor children thought it'd be a fun place to start a fire, so they burned it down.
Aww.
But every year around Mother's Day, our family goes out there, and I go out there. And some of my precious friends have gone with me, Bev, and Tim Fish took me last year. It was wonderful. And instead of a little rose bush, that picture's up there in that. Well, looky there. I didn't know that was there. But that is my mama's yard. And the roses have totally taken over the whole home place. Is that right, Tim? And the fragrance from those roses just permeates the air, and it's a beautiful, beautiful thing. So I wrote a little song about it called Mama's Yellow Roses, and I'm not going to play my guitar on this one. I'm just going to sing. Whoops, I lost my... There it is. Okay, if we just put it
over there.
All right, you guys, just kick it off and we'll just do it, okay, Donna? Still are blooming in the sun. Thank you so much. Now, we have a really good treat tonight. Look at this young man coming here. I believe he's, I'll have to let him tell you who he is. He's getting his fiddle and he's going to sing and he's going to just play that fiddle and you'll have a great time when he gets up here.
Turn it down.
Okay. Might take us a little bit to get tuned up here and get ready.
Hello, I'm Hank Williams.
1, 2, 3, 4.
What do you think of that? You know, one of my most exciting things to do is to encourage young talent. Yes, and Mr. Jeff Deaton's coming up here. You can't see it. Well, my goodness. We got to fix that. Did you hear what he said? He said you couldn't see my face. Well, he sure fixed that. Thank you, Jeff. He's Honey's husband, and he's a great sound man, great father, wonderful husband. We love him to death. I was going to tell you about Jetta. What do you think about her fiddling? Oh, there, Roscoe. Woohoo! Yeah. Yep. I've been calling him Hank, and he answers. Wasn't that good? One more time for Roscoe. Now I want to tell you about Jetta. Jetta is 14 years old, and she is the twin fiddling national champion. Yes. Woohoo! And she has a belt buckle about this big, but I don't think she wore it tonight. Did I see it about like that, Jetta? People think I might exaggerate sometime, but y'all know better than that. Anyway, we're just so happy for Jetta. And the last time we played a show for Honey's Love, Inc., when Jetta was playing a real hot fiddle tune, Sally Gooden, she set the speaker on fire. I mean, literally, the smoke started rolling and the monitor went out. But we say that she did it, you know. But anyway, we just want you to know all the good things about Jetta. And everybody up here, we had the most wonderful time getting ready for this concert. A lot of times when you have a show coming up and you have to practice, it was never that way with this one. We got to practice. It was so fun. Everybody was so wonderful to play with. So, are we ready? We're going to do... okay. Remember I told you we had a little addition today. And we want... It wouldn't be a concert without letting Honey sing, would it? Yeah. And when I was talking with Pastor Lynn about it today... I said, well, what would you like her to sing? He says, well, I don't know. He says, I like that cowboy song. Cowboy Sweetheart, you ever heard that song? Yes. You want to hear her do it?
So it's your fault, Lynn, that I have to yodel tonight. I'm sorry, I get to yodel tonight. Woo!
Yes.
All right. I hope to see lots of yodeling along with me, okay? All you have to do is move your lips real fast. You'll be fine. You ready, sister? Jed is going to kick us off. One, two, three.
I want to be a cowboy sweetheart. I want to learn to rope and to ride. I want to ride all the plains through the desert. Across the great divide, I wanna hear the coyotes singing as the sun sets in the west. I wanna be a cowboy sweetheart. It's the life I love the best. Here we go. Oh, the lady, yay. Oh, the lady, oh. Oh, the lady, oh, hey. No, the lady, yay.
Oh, the lady.
Hi, Oodle Lady. Oodle Lady.
What do you think of that? Yeah. Yep. You know, since I've been coming to Valley, I learned that God laughs over us when he's really pleased. You know, like we do with our little baby when they take their first steps, we go, yes, yes, and we get so excited. That's the way God does. He laughs over us when we do something good like that. Don't you think? Yeah. I think he's smiling. Well, I'll tell you this short little story. Did I forget something else? No? Okay. All right. Guess I'm the right place on the show. I was coming home from a tour of the desert Southwest. And you know, after you come to, it was night, late in the night. We were coming from Jordan Valley. And remember when you make that last curve and you see all the beautiful lights of the valley? How many have seen that sight? Isn't that beautiful? You never forget it. And I was so tired, and we made that curve in there. I saw those lights, and I thought, oh, I'm almost home. And I thought, wow, I'm almost home. That feels so good, you know? Then I thought about how old I was. And then I thought, huh, I really am almost home. And I got to thinking about it, and I got excited. And you know, it's almost home. Hey, then we don't have to worry about by and by we'll understand it better, because we'll have the peace and rest that we need for eternity. So I wrote this little song about it called I'm Almost Home in the Key of G. Well, I'm almost home. I can see the home fires burning. Yes, I'm almost home. I feel glory in my soul. Well, I'm almost home. I can hear the angel chorus singing glory. Long eventful journey. I've crossed the burning deserts. I have been through shifting sand. I've cried alone at midnight when my loved ones have been taken. They're standing on the shoreline and they're reaching out their hand. And I'm almost home. I can see the home fires burning. Yes, I'm almost home. I feel glory in my soul. Well, I'm almost home. I can hear the angel chorus singing glory, hallelujah. I am almost home. I'm thankful for the blessings that the Lord has poured out on me. I've tasted life's sweet treasures. I have drank the bitter cup. I held my precious babies and I rocked them by the fireside, sang them songs of heaven, and I told them of God's love. And I'm almost home. I can see the home fires burning. Yes, I'm almost home. I feel glory in my soul. Quickly, and my loved ones all around me have lived and loved and blessed the lives they touched here on this earth. But the angels lowered their chariot when their work down here was finished. They waved their hands in parting as they took their homeward flight. And I'm almost home. I can see the home
fire's burning.
I can see the wood fire's burning.
Yes, I'm almost home.
I'm almost home.
I feel glory in my soul.
Thank you so much. Now we're going to have just a little change, quite a big change in our program here. I told you that I would give an update on the prison ministry. How many of you remember that? Okay, we'll just take a few minutes to do that, and the band's going to be seated, and except Donna's going to play real soft on the piano. And I want to share my heart with you for just a few minutes. I get asked a lot of times, why do you spend your time singing in all these prisons all across the United States of America? And I just wrote the scripture down that I answer them with, and I'll read it to you. Luke 4:18. For the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, and recover sight to the blind, and open the prison to them that are bound. And what better place to find people in this situation than in the prisons, where the lady lifers without parole, what do they have to look forward to outside of the love of Jesus? But you know, that's why I go, to share the love of the Lord Jesus with those that are living in very uncomfortable circumstances. And the Lord has taken me to prisons all over the United States and Mexico. And it's been quite a ride, sometimes surprises. I was invited to a prison that housed the most violent women in 5 states. And when the female guard and myself walked inside the yard, we had gone through 3 metal gates before that, and this was the last gate. When the gate clanked, I heard people, women screaming, and I saw women running. And I thought, what in the world? And we had walked right into a full-fledged riot in the ladies' prison. And just about that time, I saw 3 huge, what do you call those people that work out all the time? Muscle. Anyway, these ladies had on spandex, and their muscles were just huge. And they were 3 abreast on the sidewalk, walking right toward the guard and myself. And they got to me, to us, and one of the spokespersons said, where are you going with that? The guard was pulling my wagon that had my guitar and the sound system, and the guard said, we're going to set up for the gospel concert in the gym. And she says, oh, no, you're not. We're having a party in there. And the guard said, no, we're having a gospel concert in there. And she said again, oh, no, you're not. And I put my hand on her little arm, and I said, honey, I'm Betty Adams. And I said, I traveled 800 miles to sing for you today. And I said, where would you like for me to set up? I said, I can set up right out here in the yard. I don't care, as long as I get to share with you. And she said, honey, we ain't fighting you. We're fighting these police. I was glad to hear that. Anyway, make a long story short, the Lord intervened. I was in lockdown for a room by myself for 6 hours, but then everything was taken care of, and the Lord gave us the best concert you could have ever imagined, and people were touched and found the Lord Jesus Christ. So he does wonderful things. Wonderful, wonderful things. So I start with, in 1981, I was doing a Pacific Northwest tour, and I had one spot left. And the promoter said, would you like to sing in a prison? And I said, sure. And it was a co-ed prison. I was about a third of the way through my time, and a guard walked up holding the arm of a young inmate, walked right up to me, and he said, the young man said, excuse me, but could I share something? And I said, sure. And he had written a poem about his little three-year-old girl that had died. And then this song tells the story. So I'm going to have a little teeny taste of water, and then I'm going to sing you that song. That I wrote a song from his poem, and I'll share that more with you in a minute. Are you bored? Okay, this is a true story, exactly the way it happened. I was singing at a prison a few weeks ago. I sang my songs of Jesus. I sang them from my soul. I told how Jesus loved them. They were precious in his sight. But I saw the pain upon their face as they bowed their heads that night. A young man stepped up to me. A guard was at his side. I knew that he was hurting. A tear was in his eye. He said, could I have a minute? Would you listen to me, please? I'd like to tell my story of my little girl and me. You see, my friends, my little girl died when she was only three. But I had a dream that she came back to visit her mommy and me. She said, Daddy, you don't have to worry ever again about me. 'Cause I'm in heaven with Jesus, where I'll always be. And Daddy, he made a promise today before I came. He said that we can be together again if you'll get on your knees and pray. Then speaking oh so softly, she turned to walk away. With a tear upon her cheek, she said, Daddy, please get on your knees to pray. He bowed his head before me as he began to pray. Father, please forgive me. I've sinned against your name. Please help me live for you, Lord. So in eternity, that heaven's light can shine on my little girl and me. So heaven's light can shine on my little girl and me. Ooh. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. And I'm going to ask Pastor Lynn to come up now. And for those of you that aren't familiar with this church, just come right over here by me. He not just my pastor, he my nephew. Yes. Bless you. And he's married to that beautiful blonde that was singing a while ago, and she's going to be singing again. But we're just going to turn it over to you, Lynn. Bless you.
This mic?
This mic. I'll get out of your way.
Oh, my. This brings back so many memories. This kind of stuff used to happen in our family room when I was a kid, about this bit, even shorter than her. I remember my uncles, my cousin Honey. It's like we have come from a very musical family, everybody but me. It's like, what happened to me?
He can sing. Well, you want me to tell him what song you can sing?
My dad told me when I was very young, oh, Lynn, I was learning to play the guitar a little bit, and I was singing, and he says, oh, Lynn, you need to sing solo. Solo, nobody can hear you. It's like, so that's how I sing. No, but in our family room, in our house, this kind of stuff happened a lot. We had this music because my cousins and uncles and everybody played something and sang. But Aunt Betty's the one that all, I mean, there was lots of country music. We're talking about Hank Williams and Hank Snow, and I can't even think of all of the kind of music that was played, but Aunt Betty's the one that always brought the gospel. That's something that's like been in her DNA for years and years, is sharing the gospel through testimony, through prayer, through just sitting on her knee, being loved on as a little kid, and just having her sing those special, special songs. And now I can't believe that she is like, she's over 70 years old now.
Might as well tell the truth.
I did tell the truth. Yeah, you're over 70 yeah. years old. Okay. 83, 84, right? Two, one.
Four.
84 years old. And she's in Valley School of Supernatural Ministry, the oldest one in the... But she is still preaching, teaching, loving on people, and just sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this is an opportunity that we have. I'm so proud of her. She's probably busier at 84 than she was at 64. I mean, her schedule is go, 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 go. But it's go for the gospel. It's like, you know, it's so incredible what she continues to do. And we're getting ready, if the ushers would come up here, to take an offering. And this offering, I would just write your check. If you're going to write a check, to Betty Adams, right? Just to Betty Adams. This is nothing for Valley Church, and it's not really for her. It's for the ministry that she does for taking the gospel to the prisons. She does prison ministry along with, I can't even tell you what all, because I don't know, but I just know she's really busy running, doing, do, preach, teach, share, sing. Preach, teach, share, sing. Pray, she's seen miracles. I am so proud of my Aunt Betty. In fact, now everybody around this church now just calls her Aunt Betty. So I'd just like to pray over this congregation, everyone that's gathered here, and over this offering. Father, I just thank you so much for what's happening here. I thank you for the wonderful memories that just comes flooding back into me of the music, what I grew up under and through. And it's just like such a beautiful, beautiful thing to share your word through music and the gospel, gospel music. I pray right now for each one that is able to give this evening, that there would be a blessing on everyone that's gathered here, and that this offering will be blessed to take the gospel to as many places as possible. It will just be spread through Aunt Betty's ministry. And we just ask this in Jesus' name, amen. If you guys will just go pass down the aisles really quick, I think that's going to be the best way so nobody has to get up. And again, if you'd make the checks out to Betty Adams, not to Valley Church. This all, everything is just directly to her and her ministry.
You're gonna have to readjust.
The most beautiful voice you've ever heard. Amen. Whoa. The angels fold their wings when Renee sings, I tell you. It's beautiful, beautiful. Thank you, angel girl. Okay. I had done that first prison, and the young man that came and found the Lord that day, he was on what they call a rider. And if they behave, then their time is shortened, they can get out in like 6 months. But he had a little accident, and he was shipped to Boise, to the big prison. And that was in 1980 when that terrible riot had happened. How many of you remember when the inmates burned the prison down and they had to live in Tent City, and it was a horrible situation? So time passed, and the young man went there, and after about 6 months, he contacted the director of religious services, and he said, you know, there's this lady that came up to the facility where I was before, and she sang these songs, and it'd be nice if we could have her here. And so in a week or so, I got a call, and I was in my kitchen at home. My phone rang, and I said, hello. This deep voice said, is this Betty Adams? And I said, yes, it is. He said, are you a country gospel singer? I said, yes, I am. He said, well, this is the director of religious services in Boise Correctional Center. And he said, we have a group of men that have been in lockdown since the riot in 1980 for over 6 months. And he said, they are violent, they are bitter, they are angry, and they are destroying each other. But he said, if we don't have any incidents of violence this week, would you be the first to come and minister to them next Sunday? And I said, yeah. And I was almost praying for violence. But I had a little 1965 Green Datsun, and I loaded my guitar in there on Sunday morning, and I went to the prison. And I'll never forget the feeling I had in my chest. I thought, oh God, you have to do this. I don't even know what to do. And then I found myself up in the front of a huge dining hall, and the doors opened on this side, and the men filed in with guards all over the place. And they were dressed in white, and they had bandages on their eye. They had bandages on their wrists, on their thumbs. They were just really beat up. And then the doors opened here, and men in orange came in and sat. And I found out these were being protected from these. And they had bandages, too. But I stood up there, and I said, you know, oh, I'll tell you why the director said he asked me. He said, I ask you, number one, because you sing the gospel rather than preach it. And he said, and number two is because you're a lady, and I think they would show you more respect. I said, okay. And so I started sharing, and I says, you know, I'm just here to tell you how much Jesus loves you and how special you are to him, and just shared the Lord, the love of the Lord Jesus. And there was a young man, blonde hair, long, mirrored sunglasses, sitting in the very back on this side, and he kept rocking his chair back and forth all the time. And he looked like a linebacker, NFL linebacker. He was huge. And I never spoke to him, but I certainly, he got my attention. But I shared, and the Lord came and bathed them in his love. And that week when I went home, I got a letter, and it said, Dear Betty, I have been incarcerated since I was 9 years old. And he said, I have not cried since I was nine. And he said, I've been totally incorrigible. And I thought, well, that's a big word. And then he said, but when I heard your testimony, he said the word testimony, when I heard your testimony and your songs today, I felt a glimmer of hope for change for the first time since I was 9 years old, and I cried. And he said, when I saw you walking away from the prison, I cried again because I felt like that glimmer of hope was slipping away. And I didn't know a lot about prisons, but I knew that was a big thing. I knew that was a breakthrough, so I just drove my little car over to the Boise prison, and I asked to speak to the director, and I showed him the letter, and his chin dropped. He says, Betty, do you know who that is? I said, no. And he said, that is the rebel of the prison. And he said, he's totally incorrigible. He said, he even beat up the judge that sentenced him. And he said, everybody in the prison fears him, and they can't break him. And so we started praying for him, and then shortly after that, I was invited out for a seminar, for a 3-day seminar, and guess who came every time? The rebel. And about the second day, about halfway through the lesson, he passed me a note, said, Betty, I want to pray now. And the director was sitting there listening like he was supposed to. And I thought, what do I do? So I took it to him, and I said, the rebel wants to pray now. He said, let's go. And so we went to a side room. He was on his knees. He cried. He prayed. He turned his life over to God Almighty. And he spent the rest of his time in prison. He spent life without parole. But you know what? He was the chaplain's assistant. And he's still doing ministry. He's out today, but he's still doing ministry. And yeah, how about a hand for the Lord? You know, he still does miracles. And I'm going to sing this little song about, would you like to hear the rebel of the prison? All right.
I'd like to tell the story of the rebel of the prison. Everybody feared the rebel's name. From the judge who read his sentence to the men who had to guard him, they'd felt the sting of rebels' powerful hands. Powerful hands, powerful hands. They'd felt the sting of rebels' powerful hands. powerful hands. They said he had no feeling. They said he had no mercy. They said they'd have to change the rebels' ways. They locked him in the dungeon. With chains of steel they bound him. But the rebel stayed a rebel just the same. Just the same. Just the same. The rebel stayed a rebel just the same. Well, I saw something different in the eyes of rebel. Deeper than the angry deeds he had done. The chains, the blows, the dungeon could never change the hurting of a heart bled, led for love he had never known. Never known. Never known. Of a heart that bled for love he had never known. Now listen to this verse. This is the happiest verse in the world. Then Rebel heard a story of a man called Jesus, praise the Lord, who came to love and set the captive free. So on his knees before him, he cried out to the Master. He asked him please to change his heart and life. Change his heart and life. And I love this verse too. Guards still search his cell block. They ask him this question. What has changed the rebel's awful ways? With a twinkle in his blue eyes and a Bible on his table, he tells them, I'm a rebel for the Lord. For the Lord. For the Lord. He tells them, I'm a rebel for the Lord.
Sweet, sweet, sweet. You know, our time's just rolling right along here. I think maybe I better move along a little bit faster. Are we okay? All right. I'm sorry? Oh, absolutely. I'm getting there. But since you mentioned it, I would like for Pam and Craig Russum to just stand up right there. Would you please? Okay. They are the coordinators for the ministry in the women's prison in Boise, Idaho. They go every Sunday, 2 hours for one service, 2 hours for another, and they, rain or shine or whatever, they are there. And we thank you guys. And they are the ones that make it possible for me to go to the Boise prison. And but I am a certified volunteer now. I have a green badge and everything. Thanks to Pam doing all the ugly paperwork for me. But anyway, yes, they are so faithful in their ministry. And I have never, in all my years in the prison ministry, I've never seen the Holy Spirit be so powerful in the services as in theirs, because they honor and love God so much. And those girls, they love them. And so last July, Pam and Craig had a baptism for the girls. Guess how many girls in July were baptized? Nope, not 70. 100, amen, that was the number. They baptized 100 people in a horse tank out in the yard. But I tell you, those girls would come out of the water with their hands in the air, praising the Lord. It was a beautiful time. Now, how many think that they got baptized in August? How many? I'm sorry? Nope, pretty close, 100 again. Wasn't it 100 the second time? They stopped counting at 75, but I know I was counting after that, and there was at least 100 or more. So, but because the girls were just flooding to the tank, and we lost, they lost count, but I kept counting. but anyway, we're so proud of Pam and Craig, and those girls were absolutely real. It was beautiful. And so, I have one more song. I had finished. I was doing a Pacific Northwest concert tour again. And I sang at a prison and did my diligence as best I could. Was on my way out carrying my guitar down the long hall. And guess who stepped out of his office? The warden. He said, "Excuse me, Betty." And I thought, how he know my name? And he said, "Could I talk to you for a moment?" And I said, "Sure." So I went in his office, because I don't think any warden had ever invited me in his office before. And he said, "I have a favor to ask of you." And I said, "Okay." Wrong word to say. No, it was the right one. But he said, "I have a girl on death row that is scheduled to be executed in 24 hours. And he said, "For the past 2 weeks, she has refused visits from her family, from clergy, from social workers. And every time we take her food, she throws it on the floor and refuses to eat." I thought, whoa. And she's scheduled to be executed within 24 hours. And I thought maybe you could take your guitar down and sing her a song and cheer her up. I said, okay. And this time there wasn't one guard. There were two armed guards that walked me down, took me down into the bowels of the prison. When I say bowels, that's what I mean. It was concrete walls, concrete floor, and we went down this long hallway till there was a solid steel door, and the guard opened that up, and then there was a barred steel door. And where did I put this? So, okay, thank you. Thank you, baby. And it was dark in that room. It's at the end of the hall. It was all concrete room. And huddled in the right-hand corner was the young girl, about 23 years old, holding her head in her hands, and her hair was falling, covering up her face. But when she saw me there with the guitar, she got up and came to the barred door, and she put her fingers over the bars and put her head against the bars and just sobbed hysterically. And so I put my fingers over her fingers, and I pressed my forehead against the outside of the bars and touched her forehead. And we both cried for I don't know how long. And then I said, "Honey, if you could ask God for one thing right now, what would you ask him for?" And without even a thought, she said, "My life." I said, "Okay." And you know, it really helps to memorize scripture when you're young, because when you need it, there it is. And I said, "Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together and agree as to touching any one thing, I will do it." And I said, "That's his word." So I said, "Do we agree as to touching this thing and taking it to God and asking Jesus to do it?" He says, "If you ask it in my name, I what? Will do it." She said, "Yes." So with her little fingers over the bar and my fingers over hers, I started to pray, and it was the most desperate prayer I've almost ever prayed. And I said, precious Lord Jesus, we are your children and we're doing exactly what you said. You said, if two of us agree and it's the touching anything, you will do it. And we prayed in the name of Jesus, and just, it was shortly into that prayer, she threw both hands up in the air and she said, he heard me. He heard me. He answered my prayer. She says, all of the weight has gone off of my shoulders. And she wept and cried and just praised the Lord. And I tell you what, guess what happened? Within 24 hours, she got a stay of execution, and they made her sentence life instead of 24 hours death. And yes, praise the Lord. And I'm telling you, I have a letter that she wrote me that says almost word for word exactly what I just told you. But she served 18 years in the system. She got out 20 years is life in Idaho. And she served 18 years, got out 2 years early for good behavior. And she works for the educational department in one of our neighboring states, loves the Lord Jesus, has served him. All the time she was in prison, she designed Christian greeting cards and was an assistant to the chaplain in the ladies' prison. So God does great and mighty things. Amen. And you know, we might not be facing death, a death chamber, but we have heartaches, don't we? And sometimes we have things that, Lord, you're the only one that can fix it. We can't. But anyway, I said to her, I said, well, honey, is there a song that you would like for me to sing for you? And without a shadow, she said, one day at a time. And I want you to know, I never sing that song without seeing that little face, swollen face, and her little straight hair hanging down and smiling, saying, one day at a time. So would you play that for me, Don? And I'm just gonna sing it. You can sing with me. Well, I'm only human. I'm just a woman. Lord, help me believe in what I should be. And all that I am, just show me that stairway that I have to climb. Lord, for my sake, please teach me to take one day at a time. Now everybody help me. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all of you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. 'Cause yesterday's gone. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus. And tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today. Show me the way. One day at a time. Well, Lord, you remember, aren't you glad he does, when you walked among men? And Jesus, you know, 'cause you're looking below, it's worse now than then. The pushing and shoving, it's crowding my mind. So for today, please teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, yes, and tomorrow may never be mine, so help me today.
today. Show me the way, one day at a time. Lord, help me today. Show me your way, one day at a time.
You know what? I just feel led to kind of change the order right now. I would like for us all to stand. And I would like for us to sing that last chorus again. Donna, would you give us that? Please. The chorus for One Day at a Time. We're going to sing it all together and lift your heart to the Lord. You know what? Like I said, we aren't facing the death penalty, but what is it tonight that's heavy on your heart? And you don't have to come up to the altar. We can just pray a all together prayer, because your pain is your pain. My pain is my pain. But you know what? Your Heavenly Father is just showering His love on you. He brought you here tonight for a special reason. Has it been good? Have you felt the power of the Holy Spirit? Yes, amen. And He's here right now. Whatever your need is, if it's your wayward children, if it's your spouse that is causing you trouble in your life. Do you know they do that sometimes? But the Lord has the answer. The beautiful thing is He has the answer. And when it's too big for us, it's just right for Him. Just right for Him. And I want us to just lift our hearts in prayer. If you want to lift your hands in prayer, you can. But I want us to pray and ask the Holy Spirit to come and give you peace and rest. He wants you to have rest in your soul. And I just, we'll close our eyes, nobody looking around. But precious, I'm going to pray right now. Precious Lord, oh, how we honor you and bless you right now, Lord Jesus. We're so thankful that you've honored us with your presence and that you care about every burden that's here on these souls tonight. We lift them to you. Lord, not just lift them, we give them. It's a count of three. Let's all put our hands out and put our pain in it and give it to Jesus. One, two, three, go. Whew. Yes. Lord, we've given you our pain, our hurt, our sorrow. And if there's someone that doesn't know you, we pray that you'll right now come into their hearts and forgive their sins and bless them, Lord, with your peace and your rest as only you can do. Thank you, precious Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You know, this is just so unlike what we had planned, but this is God's moment. This is what He wants for us. And He loves us so much. So I still have one more thing to share. Do you have enough set and time left that I could share one more story? All right, thank you. Well, you may be seated. Yep. Have a little sip of water here. Just one more story, I promise. Last Christmas, precious Pam over here, she had an idea to have the girls make one person in their family a Christmas card. She passed them out, and they had to put them all together and decorate their trees with rhinestones and sequins. And we had, 50 girls in one class and 58 in another. So there were 108 girls that made a Christmas card for someone they loved in their family. Well, guess what? There were 16 of them that had no one that loved them enough for them to give them a card. And they said, what do we do with our cards? We don't have anybody that loves us enough to give them a card. And I think Pam said, just give them to Betty and she will give them to homeless veterans. And so 16 of the girls made a card saying thank you for your service and blessing them. And Pam gave them to me, and there weren't any envelopes. But I had a sponsor that put $5 in each one of these cards. And I took them to Danny Pugmire, which is the director of the Veteran Gardens in Caldwell. Have any of you ever heard of the Veteran Gardens? Yes. Amen. All right. We took them there, and there are 12 men that are homeless and live under the Centennial Way Bridge. And that's just right down below Canyon Hill. And when I gave those cards, I put the cards in an envelope and put $5 in each one and wrote a note to the veterans saying, here's what I said. I said, to our beloved veteran, this card was made especially for you by a lady inmate in an Idaho correctional facility, wishing you the peace that Jesus gives to all who will receive him. Merry Christmas. And the director had each one of the men write their heartfelt response to those cards. And it's very, very powerful. And I'm going to try to read this quickly. The responses that the men gave, it was phenomenal. I'm just going to read a couple of them off of here. This one veteran was from the Navy, homeless, living under the bridge. Thank you for thinking of us during a hard season. Best wishes for you in the next year. This one says, thank you for your generosity. This one was from the Navy. It was a nice surprise after not having much. Best wishes in the next year. And one of them said, this is the only thing that I got. Maybe this was, you made this for me? ? Wow. And I will pray for you. God has been listening and he hears me. You can truly find freedom behind bars. So he was ministering to them. This last one I thought was the cutest one of all. This was a Marine helicopter pilot. He says, hi, I wish I could get you out with military helicopter. Just kidding, that would be a felony. Anyway, those men were so thrilled. And one, I don't have that card with me, but one said, this was the only thing I got for Christmas, was that card. And thank you a lot. And one of them, the director watched him when he opened his card and he went to McDonald's. And there was a family sitting there with a bunch of children that didn't have any money. And that gentleman bought them an ice cream cone with his $5. So, you know, I took these back to the girls in the prison. And I said, when you made that little card to that veteran, you had no idea what it would do in changing that life. And they were so blessed. They wept. They cried. They were so happy. And I shared the thought with them that I'm going to share with you. Little is much when God is in it. We don't have to have very much. Jesus says, if just give a cup of water, that it's a wonderful gift. So you might think, I don't have very much to give. But a little teeny card that in the hand of somebody that was hungry, somebody that was homeless, someone that was sleeping out in the snow under a bridge. And Donna and I bought some tarps, and Donna bought hand warmers, and we took them down. And the girls in the prison, they crocheted hats and gloves for these men. Isn't that wonderful? And I saw James today, one of the guys that received a hat and his gloves. And he says, I'm going to get me a house. He was telling my son, Clint, he said, I'm going to get me a house real soon. He has it lined up for real to rent a house. And he says, a guy gave me a 55-inch TV. And he said, I'm prouder of this hat and these gloves than I am that TV. So anyway, but little is much when God is in it. So whatever you have, even if it's a cup of water, and I just thank you for listening to me ramble tonight. I just love you so much, and thank you, thank you, thank you. And band, if you'll come back up, we're going to sing a fun song. How about that? We'll say, how about I'll Fly Away? That sound good? All right. I don't think I'll play my guitar. I think I'm just going to sing. I ain't through singing yet. Ready? In the key of C. Okay. Let's stand up for this.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, yes. I'll fly away, your glory. I'll fly away when I die. Hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away. But when
on you, we're dismissed, right? Huh? What? Oh, bye. Mwah. Love you all. Love you, love you, love you.